If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. Sorry about the delay. Our media guru is gone, and they were asking me to help, and y'all know how that goes. So not much help to anybody on that kind of stuff. But I'm so glad that you all are here. We've got so much going on here at Antioch Baptist Church, and just want to say, for those of you that don't know, today we are having a service here for Miss Mary Aldridge, who has gone home to be with the Lord. She is with Jesus in glory. We are having her service here today at 2 o'clock, and so all the church family is welcome to join in for that. Please come if you can. Also, we got a lot going on here at church. Check out this video and see what's going on. Hit the lights.
Welcome to Antioch. Let's take a look at what's going on. Wednesday, September 8th will be a called business meeting. Can't wait to see everyone there. Kicking off Sunday, September 12th will be a new member Sunday school class. Please contact the church office to register. September 23rd through the 26th is our tent revival. We'll see you at the Hardware River. Saturday, September 18th will be a cornhole tournament, also a silent auction, a food drive-thru, and all to benefit our wonderful music ministry. Awana will resume on Sunday, October 3rd at 5:30. Please contact the church office if you would like to volunteer or sign your child up. Time to start thinking forward. We'll be having the Fall Festival on October 30th. Looks like it's going to be an epic time. Volunteers are needed, so please fill out the sign-up sheets located in the back of the church. Christmas may be a couple months away, but the Boomer class is collecting gifts for the kids' Christmas shop. Please drop off these donations in the Boomer classroom. While we're on the topic of Christmas, don't forget, play practice will be beginning soon. Please fill out the sign-up sheet in the back of the vestibule if you would like a part in the play. Think we missed something? We might have. Make sure to check that bulletin.
Amen. Let's get on our feet. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you. We want to worship you this morning. We pray that you will be pleased. Receive our praises in Jesus' name. Amen. Ready?
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my
Come on,
Jesus.
Church.
Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you. Jesus. His love is strong and His grace is free. And the good news is I know that He can do for you what He's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Who can wipe away the tears, broken dreams and wasted years, till the past to disappear? Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that He would go and undo if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sin that He can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Love is strong and His grace is sweet. And the good news is I know that He can do for you what He's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Pay the price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, He makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that He can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and His grace is free. And the good news is I know that He can do for you what He's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Lord, praise. Lord, we thank You for Your ability to change us. Who knows something about the goodness of God this morning?
I love You, Lord. Oh, Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in Your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Sing that again with me. I love You, Lord.
I love You, Lord. Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in Your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. You have been faithful all my life. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the good news.
Come on, church. All our life, he's been faithful.
All my life, you have been faithful. All my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness.
Let's lift it up. His goodness is following us.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, and I give you everything. Your goodness is running. It's running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, and I give you everything. Your goodness is running.
Come on, church. One more time. His goodness.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, and I give you everything. Your goodness is running. Goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running. All my life you have been faithful.
Yes, he has.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Let's give the Lord praise. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. Lord, we thank you for your mercy. We thank you, Lord, that your joy is our strength. We praise you. When you made a way in our lives where there was no way, Lord, you have come through time and time again. Lord, your goodness and your mercy surely follows us all the days of our life, and we are looking forward to dwelling in your house forever. So, Lord, as we take a moment and give back, as we take a moment to express our gratitude in our giving right now, and the ushers come and collect the offering, Lord, I just pray that you'll help us to never forget, even on our worst day, when we're in our worst way, you are good and your love endures forever. It's in Jesus' name we pray. On this bridge. This is our pledge of allegiance to the kingdom of heaven. Right now, sing it with us. You are my king. That's our prayer this morning. Amen. Luke chapter 19, verses 11 through 27. I'm going to talk about the faithful few this morning. The Word of God reads in the Gospel of Luke, "As they were listening to this, he went on to tell a parable because he was near Jerusalem. And they thought the kingdom of God was going to appear right away. Therefore he said, a nobleman traveled to a far country to receive for himself authority to be king, and then return. He called 10 of his slaves, gave them 10 minas, and told them, engage in business until I come back. But his subjects hated him and sent a delegation after him, saying, we don't want this man to rule over us. At his return, having received the authority to be king, he summoned those slaves he had given money to so he could find out how much they had made in business. The first came forward and said, master, your mina has earned 10 more minas. Well done, good slave, he told him, because you have been found faithful in a very small matter, have authority over 10 towns. The second came and said, master, your mina has made 5 minas. So he said to him, you will be over 5 towns. Another came and said, master, here is your mina. I have kept it hidden away in a cloth because I was afraid of you. For you're a tough man, you collect what you didn't deposit, and you reap what you didn't sow. So the master told him, I will judge you by what you have said, you evil slave. If you knew I was a tough man, collecting what I didn't deposit and reaping what I didn't sow, why didn't you put my money in the bank? And when I returned, I would have collected it with interest. So he said to those standing there, take the mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10 minas. But they said to him, master, he has 10 minas. I tell you, Jesus said, that to everyone who has, more will be given. And from the one who does not have, even what he does have will be taken away. But bring here these enemies of mine who didn't want me to rule over them and slaughter them in my presence. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you will teach us what it means to be faithful as we go to your word. I just pray you would encourage, I pray you would build up, I pray you would lift up all those, Lord, who are faithfully serving you, who may be weary, who may be getting tired. I pray that you will strengthen them. I pray, oh Lord, for those who are complacent and who are not doing your work, I pray you will convict them. I pray those, Lord, for who are watching or who are here, who do not have you as the king of their life, as the Lord of their life, I pray that they will call on your name and be saved so that they can receive the reward instead of your judgment. We pray that you would do this by your Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. The faithful few. We're continuing in the Gospel of Luke in our Savior of the World series. Jesus is teaching this parable. You have to understand now, this is the last parable, the last teaching that we have before he goes into Jerusalem, before Passion Week. The next thing to happen in the life of Jesus is what we call Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry. That is happening next. Right now, he is almost at Jerusalem. He is just about to break through, and Jesus starts to recognize and realize that as he has been teaching about real faith for real life, the people that are following him really don't know what he has come here to do and what he is about to do. The disciples and the followers thought that Jesus was going to go into Jerusalem. They thought he was going to set up the capital of the kingdom of God. These people thought that the end of the world, the end of human history, was about to happen. The Messiah was going to set up the kingdom, and they were going to be a part of it. They had no idea, even though Jesus has told them now 3 times he is going to the cross to suffer and die. It is not in their mind. All they can think about is their worldly mindset and what they want to happen instead of what God is telling them is going to happen. The reality is that in the next several days of Jesus' life, almost everyone that is in this crowd with him and is following him right now in about a week is going to completely and totally desert him. his disciples, his faithful disciples, who these guys left everything that they had now to follow Jesus. They left their nets behind. They left their jobs behind. Matthew left the tax collecting booth behind. They left all that they had and everything that they knew to follow Jesus. For the last 3 years, they have been traveling with him, teaching and preaching with him. He's empowered them to do miracles and cast out demons, and he's given them authority, and all these amazing things have happened. All these amazing miracles have taken place. Every single one of his faithful disciples, except John and a few of the faithful women, are going to desert Jesus at the cross in just over a week. That's where we're at in your Bible this morning. And that's why Jesus thinks it is really, really important, before entering the holy city and starting that inevitable journey toward the cross, that his followers understand he wants them to be a part of the faithful few. Anybody here want to be part of the faithful few this morning? I think you do because you're here. And if you're watching online, I think you do because you're watching online. And we know in the real world, man, faithfulness is something that's getting harder and harder to find, isn't it? It's getting hard to find faithful. We hear about so many marriages failing because one or both partners were what? They were unfaithful, right? You talk to any business owner, you talk to any construction worker, teacher, law enforcement officer, rescue squad runner, you talk to anyone who is working hard anywhere, and one of the first things they will tell you is this: we can't find anyone to work. Most people are not faithful in life. We know how hard it is for companies to find faithful and reliable workers. We have heard repeatedly in almost every area of life, most of the work is done by a faithful few. The majority come and they go and they enjoy the benefits of everyone else's hard work. Let's get personal. Let's talk about in the church for a minute. We have heard it said in the church, right? 10% of the people do what? 90% of the work. Today, man, we make and break commitments so easily today. Without the slightest hesitation and with some of the flimsiest reasons. You know, most of the time I just don't want to do it, so I'll make up a what? An excuse, exactly. We've all had our fair share of fair weather friends in life, people who have been in your life for a period of time when you were doing well and you could benefit them, and then when times got tough, what did they do? Whoop, out the door. Hopefully you still have a few faithful ones hanging around. Many churches, organizations scramble week after week to find people to serve because volunteers back out, didn't prepare, don't show up, don't call. I'm here to challenge all of us. Jesus wants you to be his follower, and that means he wants you to be faithful. He wants you to keep your word, finish your task, show up every week, fulfill your responsibility, don't do a job halfway, don't quit, and don't get discouraged and offended at the drop of a hat. Can I get an amen? Amen. We need to strive to be one of the faithful few. How do we know if we're one of the faithful few? Very simply, in this passage, we see that the faithful few are those who wait patiently. That's something we don't like to do. We got to wait patiently. We have to work purposefully, and if we do that, then the faithful few will hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." I don't know about you. I want to be one of those who hear, "Well done." Point number one, back in verse 11, is wait patiently. Why is Jesus telling this parable? Because everyone hearing him and everyone with him, they think that it's going to happen right now. We live in the right now generation. We talk about that all the time. They thought the kingdom of God was going to appear right away. Why has Jesus been so determined to get to Jerusalem? The people know he's going. He wants to get there, and they think he's going to set up the capital. They're very aware that as soon as he reached Jerusalem, he's going to usher in the kingdom of God. He's going to free Israel from the Roman domination and establish the rule of God all over the earth. I don't know how to say it. It was like if all of us truly believed Jesus Christ was going to return tomorrow, and we had all gotten a text message from him the night before saying he was coming soon, we would all be pumped, right? We should be anyway, but I'm just saying, we would all be. That's what they thought was going to happen. They think as soon as we enter in Jerusalem, Jesus is going to start taking names, kicking butt, and sitting on the throne. They think it's going to happen right away. And so Jesus tells this story. He says, no, actually, I'm going to suffer and I'm going to die on the cross. Why? Because unless he dies on the cross, none of us can get into the kingdom. So he has to secure entry to the kingdom. And his kingdom would be a kingdom that was eternal, not earthly. But the only thing on the disciples and on the followers' mind was the temporal, worldly, physical, material things and realities. And so often we miss the point because we're so focused on the temporary, the worldly, the physical, and the material. We all do, including Pastor Dave. That's what they thought. They were not thinking about the eternal. They were thinking about the earthly. And so Jesus is using this parable to try to get their attention and tell them, look, I'm going to die, I'm going to raise, and I am that king who's going to go away to a faraway land. Jesus is going back to heaven to wait until the right time, and then he is going to return. But while he is gone, we, the faithful few, are called to do his business. So many of them totally missed the point of the parable. And so many of us, we totally missed the point of the sermon. I wish I had a dollar for every time I preach a sermon, spiritual truth. And it's like the very next day, sometimes after the very service I just preached in, people come up and they're like, Pastor Dave, I have this problem. I don't know what to do. And I'm like, did you hear anything I just said? I just preached on that. I just told you, I just gave you scripture and 3 points on how to start dealing with that. Were you listening? Were you paying attention? We get so distracted. We get so put on autopilot. We were warming up for praise team practice today, and it's so funny because we got through that last song right before offering, and what did I do right after? I looked over at John, and I said, and Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity. And I just went right into it, and I looked at John. I said, man, it's so easy for us to just run on autopilot, isn't it? And totally missed the point. Now, just to be fair, there are just as many Sundays when I preach an awesome sermon with 3 amazing points that all start with the same letter, and it's just hitting, and we will leave church, and we'll get into a situation, and I'll start fussing, and Laura looks at me and says, did you hear anything you just said? I mean, let's just be fair, right? We're all human, but we have to wait patiently on the Lord. The kingdom of God is coming. Those who wait upon the Lord, the Bible says, will renew their strength. And we know the citizens in this parable, they're the unsaved people of the world who do not want the rule of God in their life. It also represents the Jewish people of Jesus' time that did not want to recognize him as the Messiah. Most of the people in the world and most of the servants in the parable do not do what they're supposed to do. And that's just the reality of life. If you are looking for a loophole, if you are looking for an example of unfaithfulness, if you're looking for a reason to justify whatever you want to do in the moment, you do not have to look hard. God's not looking for those people. He's looking for the ones who want to be faithful. And if you want to be faithful, you have to learn to wait patiently on the Lord. Man, we hate waiting, don't we? We hate to wait. But you talk about impatient. These people in 1 week went from saying, hail him, to crucify him. They went from saying, crown him, to crucify him in 1 week. Talk about it. They went from saying, hail him, to nail him, is the sermon I preached on Palm Sunday at the beginning of last year. Talk about impatient people. They wanted it right now. So many times we want the same thing. Ezra doesn't like to wait. It's funny because he always likes to go, go, go. And he always says, Papa, beep, beep, Papa, beep, beep. That means let's go for a ride. He doesn't care where we go or what we do. He just wants to ride. He just wants to be out of the house. And I remember I told him one time that we were going to the church because I had a meeting. I was going to let him play and just wreak havoc in a room and not have any idea what he's doing. He's just out of sight, out of mind, which we would go clean it up afterwards, of course. But you know what I'm saying? We're just going to put him out there. And I'm telling you, we had to wait 1 hour. Do you know how many times he said, Papa, beep, beep, Papa, beep, beep? Like 150 times. He walk a lap in the house. Go, if you've been in our house, the living room is here, and then there's this divider that, you know, where the basement access is, and the kitchen's on the other side, and you just walk around in a circle. A lot of times we're walking around each other saying, hey, where are you in the house? You know what I mean? Like, you just get, it's kind of funny and comical when you're in it, but he'd walk a circle, Papa, beep, beep, not yet, walk a circle, Papa, beep, beep, not yet, pop, walk a circle, Papa, beep, no! Talk about impatient. I mean, Papa, you need to be patient, right? We don't like to wait. We hate it. The fact of the matter is we are called to watch and pray, to tarry, to be about the Father's business, to wait upon the Lord, to be still and know that he is God. If you're going to be faithful in the kingdom, you have to learn to wait patiently. You have to understand what that means. That does not mean that you sit around on your hands with a pretty smile on your face. We have to work while we wait. Amen? We work while we wait. As we're waiting, we are always on ready. It means patience in the Bible. And we don't like to pray for patience. We always say, I don't want to pray for patience. Well, the truth is, you can pray for patience all day long. You only get patience one way, and that's having to be patient. It's developed. It's not magically given to you. You can't just pray and say, I'm going to spend all night praying, and I'm going to worship, and then I'm going to go in the DMV and believe that the Lord is going to just give me patience. No, that ain't how it's going to happen. But it's how you wait that develops patience, right? The word patient in the Bible is so often interchanged because the Greek is so rich. It often is interchanged with words like forbearance, endurance, and perseverance. And here's another one we don't like. Long-suffering. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 in the Old King Jimmy Bible. You know what it says? Love suffers long. Some of y'all have been married for a long time. You're like, oh, I know, Pastor. Love is suffering long. I'm sure everybody here is just happy-go-lucky and hunky-dory, but that's the idea of patience. It's this endurance. It's this perseverance, and it's working while we wait. It means conducting the master's business, anticipating his return and ready for his return, but finding ourselves busy with the work as we wait. It doesn't mean we don't take a vacation. We do, but a lot of people, it's like they try to live their whole lives on vacation. And that's not life. You were created to work, and that's point number two. You have to work purposefully. Look what he says in verse 13. Engage in business until I come back. In other words, he says, I'm going away, but I will be back. And while I'm gone, get to work. It's not this, okay, I'll see you when you come back, and I'm going to sit on the couch with a bag of chips and just stream Netflix until you come back. No, it's get up and go to work until he gets back. The citizens of the world say, no way, we hate you, God, we want nothing to do with you. And that makes our job as Christians really, really hard sometimes, right? I mean, it's really, really hard when you face that opposition and you're trying to witness and evangelize and reach out and do things for the community and stand up for family values and godly values and truth-filled values. Notice I did not say traditional values. It doesn't have anything to do with tradition as far as I'm concerned. It has to do with the truth of God's word. Hello. Truth is our tradition. And it gets hard to do that when the citizens of the world say, we want nothing to do with Jesus, we want nothing to do with that king, we want nothing to do with the church, and a lot of times, if you're going to talk about that, we want nothing to do with you. That makes our job hard. Guess what? We still have to do it. Do you realize that everybody is dealing with difficulties in their life? You know why? Because life is hard and life isn't fair. It never will be. And guess what? In this story, it's crazy because it says in verse 13 that he called 10 slaves and gave them 10 minas. He gave each slave one mina, and he says, do work until I get back. You know, in this whole story, we don't even hear nothing about 7 of the 10. What does that tell me? What should that tell you? It means that, guess what? If you're going to serve the Lord faithfully and you're going to work purposely for him, you're going to have to do it with a faithful few. And we're going to have to be okay with that. Not because it's right, but it's just the way that it is. We still have to obey, even though the world hates God. And the media is slanted against God, and the culture is slanted against God. We have to serve him faithfully. Every single servant in this story is given one mina. It means that they're given the same amount to work with. We all have 24 hours in every single day and 7 days in every single week. You will never get more, and you will never get less. They were given one mina. That's about 3 months' pay. Now, that's not enough to retire on, but it's not a small chunk of change. I mean, this is a good amount of. He gave them a decent amount of money, and he says to work. They all got the same amount. We have all been given the same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. We have all been given the same mission, go preach and make disciples. And even though we're not gifted in the same way, we don't work in the same place, we all have different backgrounds, different gifts, different likes and dislikes, we all have the same calling and the same basic materials and tools to work with. It's time to get down to business. Time to get to work. Because Jesus, the Master, is coming back soon. And I'm telling you, when he gets back, he is going to want to have a talk with you about what you did with what he gave you while he was gone. Let me ask you, how are you using the Master's resources this morning? How are you using the time, talent, and treasure? Because the truth about this life is that the entirety of this life is a test. We talk all the time. I preach all the time. We go through tests. We go through trials. This entire period on earth is a test. This is a test of the emergency broadcast system. As annoying as that is, this whole life is a test for what? For eternity. It's a test. He's coming back, and this is a preparation for the life to come. This short time on earth is a practice run, and how you live and manage this life on earth will determine your placement and your role in the eternal kingdom. We will serve God eternally. You are not going to sit on a cloud with a little harp being surrounded by baby angels in pretty golden diapers singing kumbaya. That's not heaven. Heaven is with Jesus. It's working for Jesus. And I don't know what he's going to do, but it's not going to be a vacation. The reward for serving God in the scripture is always greater blessing and greater opportunity to serve God. It's always about serving. This is a serving kingdom. This is all about. Jesus did not come to be served, but to serve. You're going to work for eternity. And if you want a good placement, be faithful on earth. That's it. We get to heaven. You can't earn your salvation. We didn't earn it. He gave it to us, but he has freely given it to us. And now he expects good return on what he gave you. He expects good return. And we need to lift up the name of Jesus, support kingdom causes, find ways to serve the community in every place and in every way we can. We need to engage in business. We need to pray and encourage and be available and show up and tune in and share the post and do all those things that we can do until he comes back. Why? So that we can hear well done. Point number three. Those who wait patiently and work purposefully will hear well done, good and faithful servant. I don't know about you, but that's what I want to hear when Jesus returns. Well done. He expects a good return from his investment. He will not be okay with you hiding away in fear. Now listen to what I just said. Almighty God will not be okay with us hiding away in fear. And you hide away not just by hiding from church, but we hide in so many ways. Talked about that last week. See last week's sermon for definition, okay? We hide. None of us worked for eternal life. It was freely given to us, and now we need to give it away, and we need to invest it our life. You can do that even with COVID, even with social distancing. There's still so much you can do. You say, well, I'm worried about this. Okay, send a text message. Get on your social media feed. Share the live feed. Tune in. Say amen. Give me an amen online. I mean, share it. Call somebody. Bake a cake and leave it on the porch. 2633 Antioch Road. I like chocolate. Do whatever you can do. There are so many things you can do. We're not called to sit around and come up with excuses. We're called to engage in business until he comes back. And that's what we need to do, however we can. Getting involved when Christ returns. I don't want him to wonder, what the heck have you been doing while I was away? There's going to be a lot of people that hear that trumpet. I can't wait for that day. I don't know what I'm going to be doing, but there is a day coming, and I'm so excited when I'm going to be working on this earth, and we're going to be going through life, and one day I'm going to hear that shofar-like trumpet sound in the distance, and it's going to start sounding, and I'm going to get really light for the first time without any effort. Hallelujah. No burpees or push-ups needed, and I'm going to start going, and he's going to take me home. And I can't wait for that day. There's going to be a lot of people on that day that go, oh, no, I should have. Oh, no, I should have. Oh, no, I should have. You don't have to live that way. You can do and be faithful now. Woo! If you faithfully give what you can when you can, God blesses you and increases your ability not only to give, but he also increases your ability to receive. Because here's the truth about the kingdom of God. Until you learn to faithfully and joyfully give, you really don't know how to receive. You ever given something to somebody and they just didn't know how to receive it? They were just ungrateful. They didn't act like it was a big deal. It ticks you off. You're like, well, what the heck? That cost me something. Listen, until you learn how to truly, joyfully, and faithfully give, you don't know how to receive. But when you do, God increases your capacity. And the ones complaining about what they can't do, or what others shouldn't be doing, listen, they're going to have nothing else to say when Jesus gets back. And the real tragedy is that the complainers and the complacent are not going to have anything to give back to Jesus. I don't know about you, church, but when Jesus Christ returns, and when he calls me home, he raptures the church or punches my ticket or whatever, when I see the nail-pierced hands and I see him face to face, I want to give him more than an excuse. I guarantee you this. Hear me now. You will not be as secure in your excuses before Almighty God as you are right now. It will excuse you. Listen, you can find an excuse to get out of an obligation on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, on any day, but there will be no excuse good enough to get you out of your obligation on that day. Are you living for that day? Are you prepared for that day? Are you going to hear, well done, good and faithful servant? Listen, there are so many times I want to be able to say to the Lord, Lord, I didn't always want to do it. I didn't always do it well. Lord, it isn't much, but even when it got hard, and even when all the tongues around me were wagging, and the tongues behind my back were wagging, and even when people left, and even when people quit, and even when I had to do it in a way that was uncomfortable for me, and even when I had to love people that I really, really, really do not like. Let's just be real. If you're going to be in church for any amount of time, you're going to have to love people you don't like. But praise the Lord, there's a lot of people here that you will like. Y'all don't want to amen that. You know it's true, but that's okay. Lord, even when all the times when nobody said thank you and nobody was patting me on the back and it went unnoticed and I was exhausted and I was burnt out, I want to say, Lord, Master, here is your mina. It isn't much, but it made a few more. It made a few more. What are you doing? What are you going to say to the King of Glory? Because the one who has, more will be given. And the one who does not have, even what he has, will be taken away. I don't know about you. I want to have 1,000,000 crowns to lay at the feet of Jesus. Maybe 1,000,001. I want to be able to say, because people say all the time, well, all you're going to do is throw them right back. Yeah, but I want to have something to throw and say, look, Lord, this is for you. This is for you. This is for you. Look at what we did. Why? Because we loved you and we wanted to serve you. Not because we had to, but because we were able to. Because it's a privilege and an opportunity. My question for you is, are you going to be one of the few? When everyone else wants to be catered to, when everyone else wants to be served, are you going to be the one found waiting patiently, working purposefully so that you can hear, well done. As the worship team comes back, we're going to sing that song, Amazing Love. You are my King. Man, God has been so good to us. He's been so great to us. I think we need to respond in kind. And listen to me now. If you're here or you're watching, it's time to get down to business with Jesus. If you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you haven't repented of your sins and asked Him to come into your life and redeem you and save you and give you that hope of eternal life, that's your first order of business. That's your first order of business. That'll wake you up. Woo! All right? That's your first order of business is you got to get right with Him. You got to get right with Him. You got to receive Him. That's order of business number one. If you are saved, if you have been saved, you know what your second order of business is? You got to get other people saved. You got to get other people to Him. That's what we got to do. That's what our primary business is. Amen. And I want to say, we have so many faithful servants in this church. So many faithful volunteers. I want to encourage you to keep serving, to keep doing it. Yeah, Miss June, we got to do it 2 or 3 times this week. Miss Judy, Miss Margaret, all the other ones who are going to be here. Yeah, it's going to be, we have weeks where it seems like it's every day and it's every day and it's every day. And you're setting the table and you're setting it up and you're doing what you do, man. Keep doing it. Keep being faithful because it's so amazing. We're going to bury an awesome servant of God today who we're going to bury the body, but her soul and spirit is with the Lord. I think about Mary Aldridge in the last days of her life, in the last weeks of her life, walking so feebly down that aisle. Why? Because she wanted to be faithful to the Lord. That's what we're called to be. That's the kind of people we're called to be. We were out in the parking lot 2 weeks ago after a church council meeting, and I was talking with Miss Gloria and with Gary and Sandy, and I was just telling them, man, it's so awesome how many people in this church. We got people that they work full-time Monday through Friday, and then they still come and work full-time at the church. Thank you. We have so many other people who are using their retirement, in their retirement years. They're not just riding into the sunset. They're serving the Lord. And I was thanking Miss Gloria and the others who were there, and I'm like, man, well, we can do so much because we have so many people who have dedicated their retirement to God instead of pursuing the American dream is what I said. And I'll never forget what Gloria said. She looked at me, and she said, Dave, Pastor Dave. She didn't say Pastor Dave. She calls me Dave. She says, the real American dream. And I thought, what a perspective. Let's make that our dream. To work as hard as we can, for as long as we can, for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to work 9 to 5 Monday through Friday, and I'm going to work for him full time while I do it. And when I retire and when I can enjoy some leisurely time, oh, I'm going to serve him. I'm going to pack boxes. I'm going to make hygiene kits. I'm going to go to Appalachia and go to Zimbabwe and go right down the street and go across the community and feed the football team and feed the teachers and feed the sheriff's office. I mean, that's what we're called to do. All that we can with all that we have until he returns. That's what we're called to do. I hope you'll join me in doing it. Let's stand together and sing to the King.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your Spirit
amazing love.
joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Amen. Well done. Good and faithful servant. This past several days we've had some very, very sweet, sweet women of faith that have heard that. For everyone here, I want you to hear it too. I want to hear it. You know how we respond? We be faithful. Let's keep showing up. Let's keep logging on. Let's keep tuning in. Let's keep messaging, calling, sharing, serving. Let's continue doing the work, because it's better to be tired and worn out having done something productive than to be well rested and lazy. Let's keep serving. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I just pray for all of us, Lord, that you will help us to live our lives in such a way so that the pastor doesn't have to lie at our funeral. One day, Lord, you're going to call us home. One day, this life is going to be over. One day, you are going to return. And you're going to settle accounts. The first thing on my account I want to see that I have to have is stamped with the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for saving us, redeeming us, restoring our souls. From that day forward, Lord, we want you to see that even when it's been really hard and we felt all alone, we waited on you and we kept working. Give us the strength. Give us the right heart. Give us the anointing. Give us the love. Give us the grace. Lord, you have promised to give us all that we need. We ask for it now in Jesus' name, so that we can be your faithful servants. Bless us as we go to Sunday school and continue to learn every day that we live this week, Lord. Help us to give all that we can for as long as we can until you come back. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hello, my name's Dave, and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen." If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life.